Hi. In the previous lecture, we explored the effect of a finite wing on the drag. In this lecture, we will focus on the impact on the lift curve, and more in particular, on the lift curve slope. Remember that we defined the induced angle of attack due to the downwash at the wing induced by the wingtip vortices. The airfoil in the wing doesn't see the geometric angle of attack, but an effective angle, which is the difference between the geometric angle of the wing and the induced angle of attack. For a general wing, the induced angle is defined as alpha I is CL divided by pi A E1. E1 is the span efficiency factor, and A is the aspect ratio given by the span squared divided by the wing area. For E1 is 1, we have the elliptical load distribution, which gives minimum induced drag. Generally, E1 is smaller than 1. The angle is in radians. If we transfer it to degrees, we must add the factor 57.3 to it. Let's look at the lift curve for the profile in the wing, and for the wing as a whole. Suppose the lift gradient for the profile DCL d alpha is equal to A0. From thin airfoil theory, we find that A0 is 2 pi per radian, or 0.1097 per degree. The axial wing has a lift gradient A, and it has the same lift coefficient as the airfoil, but at a different angle of attack, the difference being the induced angle alpha I. Note the capital L for the wing and the small l for the airfoil. Since at CL is 0, there are no induction effects, both curves have the same zero lift angle. How can we determine the wing lift slope from the original airfoil lift curve? Now let us draw the lift slope curves. This is the lift slope curve for the airfoil. So 2D. And this is the lift curve slope for the wing. They have both the same CL. This is alpha effective, and this is alpha, and the difference is alpha I, the induced angle. Okay, for alpha I, we have CL divided by AE1. And for the two-dimensional airfoil, we have DCL, or in fact, this could also be a small L, but if we look at the infinitely long wing, this can be a big CL, D alpha effective, which is A0. Well, this in fact, this is DCL, D alpha minus alpha I, right? And then if we integrate this equation here, we get CL is A0 times alpha minus alpha I plus a constant. Or written differently, CL is A0 times alpha minus CL divided by pi AE1. And if we bring everything with CL to the left-hand side, we get 1 plus A0 divided by pi AE1 times CL is A0 times alpha plus a constant. Or CL of the wing is A0 times alpha divided by 1 plus A0 divided by pi AE1 plus the constant, also divided by 1 plus A0 divided by pi AE1. Now, to get the lift slope of the wing, we can differentiate this. So dCl dalpha is A0 divided by 1 plus A0 by A1. So this is the new lift curve slope of the wing. Now, if A is, this A here is infinitely big, then of course this goes to zero, and we have A0, which is the two-dimensional value for small, thin profiles. We have dCl d alpha is 2 pi. Now, for a finite wing of A is 12, for instance, if we say this E1 is 1 for an elliptic wing, then we can vary A. And if we have A is 12, for A is 12, we find A is 1.71 pi radians. And for A is 5, the value is 1.43 pi, almost 70% of the original value. So finally, the wing lift gradient is A0 divided by 1 plus A0 over pi AE1. If A0 is per degree, then we have to add 57.3 to the A0 in the denominator. This slide shows the main expressions for the wing lift and drag. The induced effects of the presence of wing vortices decrease the wing lift slope and increase the wing drag significantly. The higher the aspect ratio of the wing, the smaller the induced effects on lift and drag. Please note that the E in these equations is the span efficiency factor and not the Oswald factor, which appears in the expression of the drag coefficient for the entire aircraft, given by CD is CD0 plus CL squared divided by pi AE, where CD0 is the drag coefficient of the total aircraft at zero lift. More on this you will hear in the lectures on flight performance.